So, today's discussion is about how to handle our emotions better. This is one crucial topic where all of us need some tips to be better than our previous day. In many cases, be it at workplace, be it at home, relations, handling our emotions become a very crucial and important thing to handle. I would like to share some of the tips that Bhagavataya has shared that would come of help to us. Once I just share the tips and we'll go about having a question answer session, and as usual, as how we usually have our discussions. Okay, so I would like to quote some couple of instances. Just like how we say enlightenment, to achieve enlightenment and liberation, you don't need great effort. It just happens in a flick of a second. Just like the time you need, it is just correlated with the time taken to board, to just get on a horse. You put one leg on the saddle, and by the time that is taken to put the leg on the other side of the horse, that fraction of a time of understanding is sufficient for us to get enlightened. Okay, so if this is the case, even that small time gap is sufficient for us to handle our emotions better. I would like to quote a story from Bhagavataya's life. Bhagavataya, I can you all raise hands, whosoever has read Bhagavataya's autobiography? Anybody who has read the book can raise your hands. So, do I understand that none of you have read the book? Okay, with this understanding, let me go ahead. There was one very important, one small incident in his life. Okay, in his younger days, okay, during his college days, just when he completed his schooling and got into college, or I think during his PUC time, he was not very much into movies, or he was into other with going around with his friends and all that, and he was a bit naughty. So there was one class which was going on, and I think he threw chalk on the professor or teacher. The professor found out that it was him, and when he came to really, he was about to beat him. Okay, when he was about to beat him, Bhagavataya defended himself by keeping his hand like this. That's when his watch fell down. Okay, he was very much prepared to just retaliate the way in which the teacher was about to attack him. So he was mentally prepared, very much prepared. When he defended his hand, what happened? Accidentally, the watch fell down. The teacher hit the watch and the watch fell down. So he had to just bend down to take the watch. But just then, just a small fraction of a second time gap, that delay in the response to just bend down and pick the watch changed his mindset, and he didn't feel like retaliating with the same emotion that he had just a fraction of a second earlier. Okay, had that time gap not been at his disposal, he would have reacted the same way as the teacher did, and it would have really put his higher education into question mark. Okay, and this incident is an important learning for us in our life as well. Okay, in most cases, before we react, we have a small time gap wherein we have the freedom at our disposal whether to use the emotion or not use the emotion. But in most cases, we are becoming a victim of the emotion, and we are becoming the slave of the emotion and acting it, acting along its way. We have no control over inviting or not inviting an emotion. An emotion, whether we like it or not, anger, jealousy, disappointment, depression, everything, just like how clouds keep passing away in a clear sky, so do all emotions come, they stay and they pass. Clouds are not permanent objects in the sky. So likewise, the emotions that we undergo are also transitory. It keeps coming and it keeps going. But whether to handle it or not to handle it is at our control, which we don't realize. We think that like the emotions are so powerful and we are subjected to those emotions. But if we take a small breather, like how accidentally the watch fell down and then like you happen to grab and your emotion change. Likewise, we can, whenever cases where we feel we are like, you know, we need to take a better decision, it is an important stance wherein like, you know, we have to be conscious about what we speak or what actions we do. We can take a small breather and reflect upon our incident to take better decisions. With this thought, I open the discussion for question answers on how to handle our emotions better. As usual, the pillars of our discussion is going to be thought and thinking, agam and puram. Agam and puram, in other words, means inner world and the outer world. Okay. So with this thought, let me open the discussion for question answers. Okay. Anybody who needs to ask question can raise their hand. I will unmute you and then we can go about the process. Until someone has questions, I will continue with some more pointers on these lines. See, in most cases, when we are already in the peak of an emotion, it would be difficult for us to actually like contemplate too much on whatever we want to or how we want to. But just like peaks and the dips of the landscape, like, and so too, emotions, if you consider it to be as like, you know, a peak state of our mind, okay, in between you have a calm valley kind, okay, in our, we are not in a highly emotional state in most of the cases. So we should take advantage of those valley times or those calm times, okay, and introspect on our external relationship with people at workplace or at home. Okay, these are the people who help us, who help us in our well-being, like, you know. But in most cases, if you see to whom we have our short temper shown upon, are our like dearest ones to whom we show it out. It is because of the closeness that we have with them and the right that we take upon them. Though it is so, it would be good to also show more care towards them and show more attention towards them. To contemplate on about this in our valley time or during the non-emotional time and having a thought put in place that this is the rule, I'm not going to break the rule. Okay, I'm going to be cautious or kind enough even to the closest one, though I have right on them to show whatever emotion I get to, but I'm going to react this way. So if this is some auto-suggestion that you have in your calm times, or this is just an example, you can take whatsoever. Now, let's say you're a short-tempered person and you don't want to be a short-tempered person. You first accept being short-tempered because no emotion has a longevity. Even if you're a short-tempered person, the short-tempered is not going to stay with you forever. It comes and it goes. So just like how you connect with an emotion, automatic discussion with the disconnect with the emotion also happens eventually. Okay. It is actually every second of connection and every second of disconnection that is happening to us. In this regard, if we keep an auto suggestion to ourselves on the rules in which how we are going to have our external emotions being exhibited externally, the rules will also pop up as we have our emotions and will come of help. So the second tip is to take advantage of the calmer times of our life to think about how we have to behave in cases wherein we have earlier experienced some emotion and discomfort on account of the emotion outburst, and then handle it accordingly. Okay. So, anybody have any questions? As I said earlier, emotions internally we have no control. Say that I can have only this emotion, so and so emotions should not come to me, or like, you know, why am I feeling this kind of an emotion? We actually have no control over that. But when the emotion actually causes trouble is when the emotion which has come in the form of a thought is converted into thinking. Okay. When a thought is converted into thinking, the lifetime of the thought increases. Okay. The longevity of the emotion takes place, and as long as the emotion which has come, which we are experiencing is a negative one, the longer it stays, the damage that it does to us also increases. Okay. So we can take advantage of thought and thinking. So whenever we experience pain, okay, pain is an indicator of okay, there's something going wrong. What is it? Let me peek inside and have a look as to what's going inside. Okay, and when we enter inside and when we see, is there any action that I can take to make this uneasy better? Okay, you can go ahead, take an external action accordingly. When there's no action that you can take on these lines, just mere acceptance of the situation and not converting the emotion which has arisen inside into thinking, not giving longevity to it, okay, you will see the emotion leaving you as earlier as possible. Because once we think that we are victim of emotion and then we take upon it, then we are accountable for whatever action which is materializing. As long as in our agam, or in other words, our inner world, a thought comes and it leaves us in a flashing speed, we are not accountable for a thought which has come without our interference. But when a thought is converted into thinking, we grow it, we thrive it, we let it be with us for a longer period of time. Okay, and such thoughts will take the shape of an action as well. One classic example that I would like to give is the example of Gandhari giving a curse to Krishna. At the end of Mahabharata war, as a mother, she feels really, really sad about having lost all her 100 odd sons. She knows what is dharma, what is adharma, and why Krishna has
Thank you.
been part of the Pandavas, and the Pandavas were right, and they have fought for right. But then, as a mother, she really could not handle the sorrow of losing all her 100 odd sons. And for a second, she becomes, though she knows what is right, what is wrong, though she knows about Krishna, she loses control of her temper, and as an outcome of her temper, she gives away a very heavy curse to Krishna. The minute she gives her curse away, next second she comes to her consciousness and she says, what the grave mistake that I have done just now. Okay, so when a word is, the word is out, the word is expressed into action, it, you are accountable for that action. So here the rules of the karma will hold good. So whenever we let, become a victim of our emotion, just take a pause. Okay, you can go drink water, or you can just take a solitude, you can isolate yourself for a minute. Think of yourself from a, look at yourself as a third person and see, in this position, what am I doing? Okay, the small tiny speck of time can come as a saver for you and not let you be a victim of your emotion. So open to all of you for questions. Please raise hands, or you can type in your questions in the chat box. Whoever has questions, I'll answer. No doubt. I'm sure. If no one has any questions, if you want me to talk on any specific topic, or we want to discuss on anything beyond the topic for today, we can also go about discussing that. It's good to know in a way that like nobody has any questions to raise. But if you want to discuss something mutually, we can just go about discussing on any topics of related interests. Part of Pravadam. Okay, Shekhar, I'll unmute you. Yes, Shekhar.
Yes, good evening, ma'am.
Yes, good evening.
Ma'am, I introduced this concept to one of my friends. Mm-hmm. So he read some books and he understood basically
You're not very clear.
Hello?
Yes, can you repeat?
Can you hear me, ma'am?
I can hear you, but can you repeat?
Okay, I introduced our concept to one of my friends.
Oh, you introduced a concept to some of your friend?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, he read some books and he understood the basic concept.
Okay.
But what happened after some times, he met, then he was in sad mood naturally, correct? His question was, even after I understood this concept, he was in sad mood. Question came from him. Could you please discuss regarding it now?
Yeah, can you also write it down in the chat box? Because I didn't get your message. You said that you introduced this concept to one of your friends.
Correct.
Read various books. Okay, those books are related to Pravagam.
Yeah, Smashwords Arrows, for instance.
No, oh, okay. Yeah, so he read the books. After that, what happened? After that, I'm not clear.
You know, there was some unhappy moments in his life.
Okay, unhappy moments in his life. And
the question is, even after read and understood the concept, why my mood is very sad? Why I am going to, you know, sad feelings?
Very good. Okay, so, you can just, I'm just giving you an metaphor. Our mind is like a mirror. Okay, it reflects whatever it sees upon. I mean, whatever is shown to it. Okay, shown to them. Whatever is our senses cover, like, you know, that is reflected on our mind. Okay, just like how the sky is clear on certain days. Certain days it's cloudy. Certain days it's thick and foggy. You cannot see any blue sky at all. You can just see clouds. So too, every emotion, okay, every feeling, okay, one day you will be like, you know, flying on the sky just because you did something amazing, you yourself feel good, or like, you know, your people around you, be it at workspace or like your friends or your family members, they appreciate you for something that you have done. That day you will feel light and you will be floating on the air. Another day somebody might criticize you, okay, and you would feel sad about it. Or let's say nobody criticizes you, but let's say you want to do some work better than what you have been doing. Okay, just imagine how a baby crawls for the first time. Okay, it puts in so much effort. Okay, and when it is done, it is happy. Then again, until it does, you can also see some small babies trying to get what it wants to do. Okay, so emotions come in, be it externally or be it internally, that can be a push to do something, for you to take you to the next level. Okay, so our attention should be that we cannot say I should not feel sad or I should feel happy. No emotion stays permanently. Just like how I told you the story about the water. Okay, we have a feeling that after reading all this, after getting through all this, we will be very in a pleasant state of mind all the while. No, that's not the case. All emotions will come through us. Okay. All sadness, anger, bitterness, everything will come. But the lifetime, the duration of the emotion that comes would be a short-lived one. Okay. And our attention will not be on the emotion which is coming inside, whatever it is. The only key is to accept the state of mind. And not even bother about it. But when you have sadness, you can see, okay, what is causing this sadness? Is there any external situation or anything that I can act to make the situation better? Then you can go about the very purpose of the pain has come for you to bring your notice so that you address the notice. But there are certain cases wherein there can be nothing that you can do about it. Okay. just see whether is there any scope of any action that you can take or no scope. If there is any scope of action that you can take, you can go about taking that action. Okay, so you will continue to feel sad or happy or angry or whatsoever. Okay, we will never, in Prabhagam, we will never say that, like, you know, once you get to understand this and then, like, you know, you consider yourself to be as enlightened or liberated. You accept all these emotions without any inhibitions. Okay, anything can come, anything can stay for however long it wants to. And then you will see that the emotions that you've not invited for yourself will leave at the speed in which it has entered you. Have I answered your questions, Shekhar?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Agree.
Okay, you can let this know to your friend, so he need not feel sad about having a sad feeling. Once you accept, then the sad feeling will not disturb you anymore. You let it be with you.
Yeah, actually, I understood from his question, by attaining the wisdom or this liberation, always we will be in happy mood. This is his thinking.
Mm. So that,
but it is not correct.
Just like how a water has no taste for itself, it is not as bitter as a bitter gourd juice, nor as sweet as a lemon juice or a mango juice. It's just water. It has no taste for itself. So too, enlightened or a liberated state has nothing. Is neither happy nor sad nor angry or no emotion. It is just like the gap between each and every word. Okay, each and every word there is a space. So too, between each and every emotion there is a gap. Okay, there is a manolaya wherein you get connected to an emotion, and then a manunasa wherein you get disconnected from the emotion that happens. Just like how, but for the manunasa to happen, there is no effort that you need to put. It happens automatically. It is natural state. Okay. So you get to know that there is a happening and there is a disconnect. There is a happening and there is a disconnect. And that is where you know that, okay, you're actually a new person every other second. Okay. With that thing, we know that we need not prolongate the emotion. The person who felt sad a second before is not the person who's feeling the sadness right now. Just with something called memory that we are having, we feel that we are continuing to feel angry. But actually, it is every other second is experienced afresh by us.
Agreed, ma'am. Actually, I understood one of other thinking, ma'am. For instance, when we think about Lord Buddha, you know, always from childhood onwards, we are seeing very calm and polite and smiling face only. So he is also thinking that if we attain liberation, he will always be calm. This is actually basic problem, I feel.
See, it will eventually happen. Okay, how it will eventually happen? Internally, Buddha would have... See, that is when Buddha was actually struggling to have a control over all his emotions and all his state of mind. He wanted his mind to be in a perfect state of... in an undisturbed, in a self-contained state, he wanted to keep his mind. And for which he did so much of tapas and meditation. He had so much of spiritual practices to keep him in line with that. At the end, when he surrendered to his inability, okay, he sat down near the Bodhi Mara and then he gave up himself. He's like, no, done all that I could do. Okay, that's when Nirvana was experienced by him. Okay, so when you accept you are in a state of mind, you can see that there's nothing that is staying. Okay. And emotion, so what would happen is that the minute you accept it internally, you can see it reflecting externally. Okay. All that you have to keep is one single point, that externally when you react, you're accountable for your reactions. Internally, you cannot, like Buddha himself was defeated. He accepted his defeat. The minute he accepted his defeat, he found nirvana. Okay. He said that, okay, I am in a state of mind which I really wanted. What state I wanted to be in, I have attained that. But for me to have attained this, I did nothing. Without me doing anything, I am here. That is what he found. See, our body, whenever there is some repair, damage in the body, our body has the capability to repair itself and fix itself. So too, our mind has a natural ability to repair and fix itself. But in most cases, what is happening is that even before that, the body or the mind repairs itself, we try to help the mind and we try to solve the problem, thereby creating more calamity. Okay? But when you leave it undisturbed, you can see it settling by itself. Just like how a ripple is, a problem is like a ripple thrown on a crystal clear water. Ripple comes out. But then how to address the ripple? You address the ripple just by not doing anything to it. The ripple subsides by itself. And this was observed by Buddha, that without us doing anything to get to a calmer state of the mind automatically gets to that. Okay, you just don't have to disturb it. Right? So Buddha might look he might have a very pleasant face, and Buddha is depicted that way. Because of acceptance that he has, he accepts whatever is internal to him, that externally he has control. He has control over the thread. Okay? Do you remember the story of the candlelight that I told? Like, let's say there is a candlelight. Okay? And you are flipping your hand on top of the candlelight. Okay? If you just flip in and flip it, you just swipe your hands across, you might not feel the heat of the candle very intensely. But the longer you stay on that, it will burn your fingers, and the resultant, the pain is reflected on your face. Buddha also never stayed with his emotions for long. Okay. Or he never converted he was in a state of nirvana wherein he saw everything transitory, just like how the clouds were passing through the clear sky. He saw everything that was passing through him. When he saw that, he was unaffected by, like, you know, now let's say all the emotions were flipping through the candle and nothing were staying on the candle for long to damage him, and that is one reason why we never saw pain in his face. It was always a contented face. But this comes with understanding. Okay, just by understanding this, you will see it reflecting in our day-to-day life.
Yes, ma'am, well said. I could understand. So as per our concept, can we say, instead of that same single face of Buddha, the nine moods of, nine status of moods, in Tamil we are saying Navarasam, no? So all faces of Buddha will be there, but actually all moods also might have comes to Buddha, but by his wisdom, he couldn't, express all these things, or he doesn't want to express. So he keep passes sometimes. Am I correct, ma'am?
Yes. So he, before materializing that emotion externally, he had control over his. He had a gap between his agam and his puram. Okay. He would have a judicious decision on how he is expressing anything. Okay, externally. So that is why he was, this is again, I've not had any personal conversation with Buddha, but he is a person who experienced nirvana, okay? And with his thing, he for sure has accepted all emotions internally. And that would give a good control over the external emotions. Mari, I would come to you. Your hand is raised. I will answer your question. I will get to your question now. We might have to, before I go ahead with your question.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. Yeah, this is Mari, right?
Yes, ma'am. I'm from Chennai only, ma'am.
Okay. Hi, Mari. Small request, Mari. In connecting through the Cisco WebEx, right? The Cisco WebEx free meeting is available only for 15 minutes. After that, it would get disconnected. Okay. So now if we go about taking your question, right, you might end up immediately disconnecting. So what I will do is that now I will cut this call and immediately connect back. So all of you can immediately connect back and I'll take your question. Is that fine with you, Mari?
Okay, ma'am. What no issue, ma'am.
I'll connect and I'll drop this meeting and immediately connect back. All of you can connect back immediately. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mari. Mari?
Yes, ma'am.
You can ask your question.
Ma'am, how to get this study plan?
Can you repeat?
Hello, ma'am?
Yeah, can you repeat?
To get concentration on studies, ma'am.
Concentration on studies. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. But then automatically my mind comes over continuously.
But automatically your mind comes to?
Yes, I mean that. And
no, you're breaking. Chat or can you? No, I think you have to type. You're breaking. Your mind gets distracted. How to get more concentration on studies, but when you want to sit and study, your mind is wandering. Your mind gets distracted.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah, so Mari, with respect to study or with respect to your work, okay, your involvement to you're connected to something. Okay, how can you get deeply connected to something is with the importance that you give to that work. Okay. See great artists painting, okay, or dancers, okay, they are intensely concentrating on the action that they are doing. Why they first thing, they like it. Okay, now let's say you are doing something that you are not really liking, okay, then it could be difficult that you get distracted. When you are doing something that you are really liking, automatically the concentration will come your way. Okay. But not all the work that we do in our day-to-day life is something that we like. Okay. We have to do certain things even though we don't like. Okay. In cases for us to do that work, what comes of help is the importance that we give that work. Okay. So let's say daily morning you feel you need to get up by 5 o'clock and go for a walk. Okay. But daily morning, 5 o'clock, the alarm rings, but you feel like snoozing it off and sleeping. Okay, don't feel anything up. Okay. But another day, you have a flight at 4 o'clock. Okay. Will you snooze this?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
No, ma'am.
Why? Because you traveling is very, very important. You have something important to address that. You don't snooze the alarm, you get up and you go about whatever you plan to. So the key here is the importance that you give to that activity. So just like in the beginning of the discussion, I said, there are tips and tips. Okay. There is a calm valley time wherein we are not controlled by our emotions. So at that calm times of our day, we can take advantage and we can program our mind on setting the importance to whatever we want. Okay. When you set something to be as really important, it will automatically help you stay focused on that activity.
Okay, ma'am. If we have more interested, then rational study.
Yeah, if you really like what you are doing, concentration will automatically come. You don't have to put that forcefully.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Okay. One thing is developing interest. The second thing is considering that it is important. Okay. When you
think
it to be as important, automatically the focus will come in.
Initially, I can start ahead, but after that I question the studies.
Okay, so you can,
interested if interested. I...
Yes, so
okay, ma'am. Please, ma'am.
No. What I'm trying to tell is that, see, it is the decision that you are making. Okay. You decide, once you decide that I am going to be like this or I am going to achieve something like this. Okay. You set a target for yourself. When you set a target for yourself, you will see that your body and mind cooperating and helping you achieve that. Okay. For example, you see weightlifters lifting 100 kilos of weight. Okay, they are also like us. How is it that they are able to lift 100 kilos of weight effortlessly? Because they have programmed their mind and they've taken training physically and mentally. They've been training. That's on that fine day, they are able to lift that. Okay.
Okay.
So too, okay, you can program yourself to get this done. Anybody else? Yes, Mari.
Can you reprogram about any person? I decided something like that. But when I see someone, repeatedly I get bad things about them.
No, I'm not understanding. Can you repeat? You can either chat or no. Yeah, I didn't understand you, Mari. You can chat. Yeah, can you chat? Can you write it down in the chat box? Mari, you can write.
I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Suburatnam, let me unmute you. Yes, Suburatnam. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, I can hear you. No, your connection is a bit poor.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Okay. See, if somebody.
Yes. Sir, can you chat? Write it down in the chat box if you are.
I'll do that.
Okay, in the meanwhile, if anyone has any questions. Subratnam sir, I hope you're typing your questions in the chat box. Just check whether your network is better now. Ma'am, could you please explain how to reprogram our subconscious? See, you need not. I actually didn't get to see. Okay, so basically, we don't prescribe too much about reprogramming and all. We internally we let the mind be free. Okay. That is when the mind operates in its fullest, and that is what we call as pravagam. Okay. You use the mind as and when required, and you don't all the while. See, just because we have cell phone, not necessary that all the while we should keep it like, you know, keep fiddling with the device. When you are using it more than when it is necessary, it damages your eyesight and it brings about various other radiations and other problems. But you use the device judiciously. Likewise, we, after understanding as to how the mind is functioning, we use the tool judiciously, okay, and rest of the time the mind is free for itself, okay. So likewise, reprogramming our subconscious is when we need to correct ourselves in terms of external decisions and external actions that we take. So let's say, for example, we have an habit of being short-tempered, okay, and then we go about reacting, okay, be like, you know, letting emotions free internally is different from letting emotions free outside. The minute you let any emotion outside, okay, you are accountable for it based on the person to whom you are interacting with. And it would create more calamity, that it is more like a feedback circle, and then it keeps coming back to you. Okay. So that is when we need to introspect. Okay, what's happening to me? What am I doing? Okay, and for me to make my situation and this entire thing better, what action I need to take? Okay, so that is a good case of reprogramming your subconsciousness. That means reprogramming your habits. Okay. So you contemplate on the pros and cons of a which is being outburst, okay, and then you can put an auto suggestion for yourself. Okay, so if I continue to do something like this happens. Okay, this damage has already happened. So what can I do on these lines? So if there's some patch up or some work around for whatever has already happened, we can go about doing that work around, being in terms of talking, just a simple act of talking and apologizing to people. On the other hand, let's say a damage has happened and there's no going back or nothing can be done to fix the repair, then it's just a matter of accepting and being conscious about it. Okay, just an auto suggestion will help you set a strategy, how you set alarms in the cell phone. Okay, auto suggestions are alarms which will come away the next time you are encountering that. Okay, so it will come of help to you. Okay, how to Subbu, your question is like how to respond if somebody tried to take undue advantage of your lenience. Generally, it triggers an anger in me. Is that right? It is perfectly right. The anger has come for your help. See, flowers, rose flower has thorns in it. Okay. Different animals have different protective mechanism. A porcupine has thorns. Okay. Nature has given various defensive mechanisms for various creatures. So too, the emotions that we come in can sometimes be of help. Okay. So when somebody is going beyond their limit, it is due that you communicate assertively that they don't take advantage of you. Okay. So you can express and communicate the limit that they have and not go beyond that or take advantage of you. Okay. But that not necessarily that you have to show a negative emotion to show it out. You can express your thought assertively without damaging. See, a conscious person is will neither succumb nor show out strong emotions. Okay, so you can be that's more of a defensive. In our ancient, in our culture, we have so much of defense mechanism, though we have not been very aggressive on other countries. Why? It's then we are very strong. You are neither attacking them and you are not letting somebody attack you. Okay. So it is perfectly right. The anger that you are experiencing has completely come all the way to help you out, but not necessary that you should show it out, but you can use the anger to keep people in their respective places whenever they are crossing boundaries. Okay, so let me unmute Prem. Yes.
Can I ask the question?
Pardon?
Can I ask the question?
Yeah, go ahead.
So basically, according to my concept, all we have to accept inner what it is, and we have to work on externally.
Yes.
One thing, our mind always means the inner thing always need happiness for everyone. So we have to be happy.
Happiness?
In our
happiness
means internally we everyone means in the world internally everyone needs to be happy. Okay. So this expectation is correct.
Yeah, that expectation is a showstopper for you to accept the reality. Okay. So you want something, you think that if internally all the while we need to be happy. Okay. So that thought, whenever you're not in a happy state, makes you feel that like, you know, oh, I am not happy. I need to be here. For me to be here, what should I do? Okay, you end up finding something to solve your current state. But the actual thing is, the minute you accept, it's okay for me to feel angry, it's okay for me to feel sad. Just like in the previous case of money, whenever people were taking advantage of this lenience, he was feeling angry. Okay, the anger has come to save him. Okay, So too, now just imagine, like, you know, different people in different profession need to be really hard and fast. Okay, now let's say I have to be happy internally. Then how will they be hard and fast externally? But now to maintain law and order, let's say certain profession needs people to be really strict. How will they show it out? The emotion comes for help. Okay, but the problem is when we stay with the emotion for a longer period. Okay, we should know to connect, and we should, the minute you accept and let it free, it comes, it will get your job done. Then once the job is done, however strong you are, you pull an emotion and you ask you to retain with yourself, you can't. Even a short-tempered person can't stay for 5 continuous days completely in anger. Okay.
Yes.
An emotion comes and it leaves. But before it takes external action, you should be conscious as to what kind of a damage that it is going to cause. Because the minute you materialize something, we are accountable for it. Okay. So just a small check on that will really come.
This is my last question.
Yes.
So basically, all human beings should not expect that something should be calm inside internally. Whatever happened, let it happen. If we should not expect happiness also, we should not expect anything. Sorrow, happiness, anything we should not expect.
Yes.
Which is our duty, we have to do it. Output will come. Have to happen.
Yes. See, happiness is like expecting sweet. Okay. So,
okay.
If I eat sweet, it will be nice. But all the while, if you keep having sweet, okay, you will not rejoice or enjoy sweet. Okay. You need all taste and all. But what is the taste of the tongue? The taste of the tongue is neither sweet nor bitter nor sour. It has no taste for itself. So, too. Internally, we think that we need to be happy, but actually internally there's nothing that stays. There is no, it's neither happy nor sad nor nothing. Okay. It comes, it shows you, like, you know, when an emotion comes, your mind reflects and it connects with it. There is a layer of whatever is happening and it shows you, okay, there's something like this. But once it is done, it is gone. Right?
Okay. Yeah. So... here one question is, so all the people are trying to be happy. For example, they are going for outings, they are buying new things, they are trying to make them happy. So it means they are feeling sorrow inside. That's why they are trying this opposite. Am I correct or?
Not necessarily. See, sometimes now let's say you are feeling so sad, you want to change, and then you go take, give yourself a break. Okay, I've had enough. Okay, and you go for a day out, you distract yourself on other things. Okay, but not all the while all people do it. But naturally you might feel happy, naturally you might like to enjoy nature. Okay, so not the case that only when you are sad or when you have a negative emotion, you distract it with the other one. Okay. Sometimes you naturally feel like enjoying. Life is all about enjoyment. Okay. The entire life is bestowed upon us. It's a miracle that we are here. Okay. Just imagine in the vast universe. Okay. There's one solar system and there is life on one single planet. And everything on this planet, right from plants to flowers to animals to the mountains, to everything is a miracle. There is life. Water is a miracle. Air is a miracle. Okay. So instead of enjoying this beauty, half the time we are prisoners in the slave, prisoners or slaves to our mind. Okay. So if we just can not succumb to the pressure of the mind and have mind under our control. Okay, use mind, not even control your mind. Know how to use the device. Okay, know how to use your cell phone. Okay, that the cell phone doesn't, like, you know, you are not all the while having a cell phone. You use the cell phone at your disposal. So likewise, just a small understanding of the mind will help you reflect on the beauty that we are currently enjoying.
Okay, well said, well said.
So, Boo, sir, I'll unmute you.
Hello.
Yes. I can't hear you, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now I can hear you.
My question is, as I'm saying, after so many lectures, sometimes I go to the move.
Sir, you're breaking. Can you type your questions in the chat box?
Okay. Okay, I'll do that.
Okay. Despite having understood the concept, the mind goes into mood swing mode. How to overcome that? You need not do anything to overcome that. So you accept that mood swings are natural. Okay, it will happen. Okay, your external situation is creating some disturbance internally. Okay. See, both though we talk about external and internal, there is a very small gap between your external world and your internal world. Okay, anything on the, now let's say you fall sick. Okay, your mind and your body is so connected that the minute you fall sick, your mind also tends to feel a bit low. Okay, on the other hand, let's say you're having some inability or something, but let's say your mind is full of josh. Okay, you don't feel that, you don't, now let's say you are having some pain in your leg or hand or something, but the minute you're very, very happy about something, you tend to forget your ache. Okay, so we are, the body and mind are so closely connected that any disturbance in our external world will create ripples and will create some disturbance internally, and it is perfectly fine. You have to accept that this is natural for us to happen. The minute you accept that, then you get the bandwidth to focus on what is the disturbance that has come upon. Is that disturbance some directed externally? Is there any need of action that I need to take and to externally and fix the problem? The disturbance has also come to bring to light of whatever problem it is. Okay, a classical example was about the the story that we discussed last week about a person who have understood the concept, and he was feeling really a contented, calm peace of mind for some months. And one fine day, he had to attend a meeting. So he got ready and he was in the bus stand waiting for the bus to go to the nearby town to attend the meeting. And the either he missed the bus or the bus came pretty late, that he was waiting for it for longer and he couldn't make it. And he started, like, you know, feeling tensed. Okay. And then he was so tense that he was wondering, after having understood so much and so long, I was in a very calm state of mind. Now, how come the calm state of mind left me? Okay. So, having not achieved the so-called enlightenment or liberation that we are talking about, and he called Bhagavad-gita. He said, like, you know, see, so long I was fine, but today I am so tensed. Why? How can I feel tensed? Okay, that was the question he asked to Bhagavad-gita. And Bhagavad-gita said that, see, the tension has come for your health. Okay. You consider the meeting to be as important. That is why, having missed the bus, you're feeling tense. Now you can take advantage of the feeling and see if you can attend the meeting by any other means, by taking an auto or booking a cab or any other means. And then let's say if there's nothing else that you can do, you can at least call them and inform them that you're coming late. Or for you to take all these actions, the emotion has come as health. Now let's say you're going on a trek to a deep forest with your friends. Okay. When you go over and you're heading closer to the middle of the jungle, you see a big tiger just beside you. Okay. What will you do? Okay. You will run as fast as your legs can carry, and you will see that your BP is overshooting 4 times, 5 times its normalcy, and you see all sweat covering your body. Okay. So the emotion changes also result in physical changes, and they give you so much of power to handle that situation. And once you are in a safer place, if you want to shoot your BP 4 times, or if you want to create sweat around you, I don't think you can ever do that. It is a natural phenomena. So naturally, mood keeps changing. Okay. And all you have to see is whether it has any call for action or not. And if it has no call for action, before you expressing it out, before you expressing it out, you can think about the consequences that it is going to have, because any emotion, when it is expressed externally, you will be accountable. Okay. As long as we don't damage or, like, you know, hurt anybody outside, it's fine. But the minute we do, we will be accountable to the results as well. So just a small conscious thought on that will help you have a better relationship with people around us. But if that happens without any reason, you accept it happens. Okay, the clouds in the sky keep coming in and keep coming out, with reason, without reason as well. Okay, so any emotion can come. For no reason you can feel sad, for no reason you can feel happy. Okay, the key is accepting. Okay. Anything can come through me is the key. Fine, have I answered you, Subhu sir? Prem, do you have a question, or is your hand already raised?
Sorry, I'm not able to.
Okay, lower your hands. That's fine. Okay. So, anybody else? Any other question? Okay, thank you all. It was a wonderful discussion. Hope to see you all next week with fresh set of questions. Thank you very much.